I discover something new about the SCP universe every time I load up the wiki. There are so many articles, it's hard to believe that everything is out there waiting to be read. Even if you don't like the more popular SCP entries, or you feel like they're a little played out, there are plenty of stories that might cater better to your tastes. It's a veritable treasure trove of terror and creativity. The more you read, the more invested you become, finding more and more entries that flesh out the hidden world even more. Some stand alone, some blend in with the crowd. Regardless, you'll be coming back for more. It's almost out of the ordinary how fascinating this content is. Like, there could be something compelling readers to continue on down this rabbit hole. Do you think that the wiki is anomalous in itself? Hello, horror heads, and welcome back to the scariest channel on YouTube, Top 5 Scary Videos. I'm your horror host, Keegan Hughes, and today we are counting down the top 5 scary SCP monsters that can never escape, part 13. Before we get started, make sure to give this video a big thumbs up and subscribe for more terrifying creatures. Wicked, let's begin. Kicking us off at number 5, we have SCP-860. Now, some doors are just meant to remain shut. Nowhere is this more apparent than within the pocket dimension SCP-860 brings into existence. The SCP itself is a dark blue key that looks like any other key. At random, a series of numbers will appear on it, representing coordinates for somewhere in the world. So far, the coordinates have marked out locations in Germany, England, and at a Foundation site. The key will fit into any door lock in the area of the given coordinates. When the key is inserted and turned to open the door, the threshold will lead to a different location. A small forest clearing with a footpath will be revealed with blue mist hanging in the air. As soon as someone enters the door, it will automatically close and lock behind them, leaving them alone in the forest. No turning back. If the subject follows the footpath, they'll be led to another similar door, which will lead to the usual location of the original door. Through many explorations of this area, some strange occurrences have been discovered. Weird, distorted howls have been reported by subject, as well as the sensation that they're being followed. The first couple subjects made it through alright, although the second reported being beckoned by something. The subject disappeared off the path to follow it, and the key remained stuck in the door for 7 months. Nothing was gonna remove it. At the end of this time, the subject returned, noticeably aged and with a calmer demeanor than before. Subject 3 attempted to destroy the door, which apparently was a very bad call, because then a large paw appeared on the camera feed and no one's heard from them since. In the most recent exploration following that one, the mist actually appeared red instead of blue, and the path changed from dirt to cobblestones and also became forked. The man was hunted by whatever had been stalking the pines up till this point, and before audio cut out, a strange noise was heard. If you take the clip and play it backwards, you hear, "I see you." What the motives of the creature are, I cannot claim to know. What I do know is that it's big, strong, creepy, has yellow eyes, and is able to kill humans. If it escapes the anomalous doors, it can and likely will wreak havoc. Coming in at number 4, we have SCP-3312. This mimetic agent exists under the false identity of a fan website. It sneaks its way into people's lives and makes them compulsively consume products, media, and content related to various fan bases. The most notable fan base related to 3312 involves furries, a tale as old as the internet. However, the anomalous effects will only take hold of those with no prior involvement in the furry community. So upon being exposed to the mimetic agent, folks will display a heightened interest in anthropomorphic characters in mainstream media. Sonic the Hedgehog, anybody? This will intensify over time through 6 marked stages. Soon they'll initiate participation in the furry community, including the creation of a fursona and joining in on the roleplay. After this, affected individuals will seek out internet users who share negative views on the community and also expose them to 3312, bringing them into that community. At this point, the spread increases exponentially and anyone involved will become borderline obsessive. This could look like many things, including running several roleplaying accounts, the purchase of animal costumes, consistent attempts to contact a prominent member of the community called Ollie Fox, and the creation of a political party concerning the desires of furries. After this, the individuals will assume the role of a prepubescent child and will cease to be able to attend their own needs. Their living conditions rapidly become unfit for any human and they abandon any people outside of their online community. Then they'll undergo the delusion that they are indeed an anthropomorphic character and perpetuate this by any means necessary. This results in rejection by the non-anomalous community, following events like attempted intercourse with animals, heat-related deaths associated with animal costumes, deaths from great heights among those with winged animal characters, and firearm attacks. The final stage of this anomalous transformation involves total loss of higher cognitive functions. The individuals will regress to instinctual behaviors, and their prior personality will be destroyed. They still possess human speech, but it'll be characterized by childlike pronunciations and heightened pitch. The final stage also involves heightened aggression towards all people, and the 3312 sufferers will kill indiscriminately, all while saying things like, "Hello, Mr. Police Officer." My goodness. Coming in at number 3, we have SCP-2718. Now this one's interesting because some Foundation personnel want it buried, while others think the world has a right to know about it. We'll see if it ever makes it to the public at large. 2718 is apparently a cognitohazard, but if you look a little closer, you'll notice that it's actually just insanely hard to find in the Foundation database. It's consistently being pushed deeper and deeper and deeper, with additional layers of security added. The fact that it's on Dameron clearance is stated like 5 times in the article. Plus, the classification and number keep changing, so somebody wants to make sure this stays hidden. So what is 2718, really? Are you sure you want to know? Okay. Well, it's the fact that your mind and consciousness remain in your corpse after you die. This means that you feel your own body decaying, breaking down, being consumed, etc. And the pain doesn't stop when your body ceases to be either. Nope. Everyone will just be in intense agony forever and ever and ever. No mouth, no screaming, just immeasurable pain, even after the worms are done with you. This was all discovered when the council resurrected 0511, who then reported on what the afterlife was like. Pretty terrible by the sounds of it. Everyone is afraid of this discovery and its implications. For those reasons, the 05 council has decided to try to stop human death forever. So far, they haven't been too successful. Soon after the initial discovery, somebody clued into the fact that everyone is anomalously scared of 2718, and it should probably be erased from memory altogether. But before it could be totally wiped, 0511 decided that people had a right to know and ensured that if somebody tried to delete or edit the entry, large portions of the database would become corrupted. The council still went through with their plans though, killed 05, and erased 2718 from everyone's minds. Now it's chilling in the deep, dark depths, trying its best not to be discovered. But now you know! Who's excited for an eternity of formless suffering? Plowing its way in at number 2, we have SCP-2571. We're not really sure if this is a real place or not, but ideally it will be prevented from spreading any further than it already has. This is quite difficult though, as it's just a dream, affecting people with seemingly no pattern. Cragglewood Park consistently appears in the dreams of 0.05% of the world's population. It's mostly common among adults who are raised as only children, but this is only one trend that's been identified. The dreams are largely upsetting to those who experience them, as they associate them with their own memories, even though there's no evidence of them ever being to the seemingly fictional theme park. Amnestics do purge these memories at first, but they always seem to resurface once treatment wraps up. Wherever these memories are coming from, they want to remain in the minds of people no matter what. Recurring themes include being between the ages of 4 and 12 while visiting, there being numerous anthropomorphic trees and plants present, no adults around, calliope music, and other unknown children being around. And there's only one ride, and that ride is a carousel. While there were always other kids on the carousel, the subjects interviewed never rode. You'd think that a theme park would involve all smiles and laughter, right? Well, the kids in the memories do smile and laugh, but only to keep from crying. Subjects have claimed to want to keep the trees happy to ensure that they didn't know they were scared. But this is all a dream, right? What's the big deal? Well, actually, one subject in particular found an old cassette tape labeled Cragglewood in their childhood home. It documents the experience of two children making their way through the park. In the end, one child has to go on the carousel, and one does not. This knowledge is very upsetting to the two children, and after some teary-eyed goodbyes, they part ways. Screen grabs from the tape were uploaded to the wiki, and let's just say I can understand why the kids were so upset. These smiling tree mascots are not as friendly as one might imagine. And it seems that being raised as a single child doesn't always mean you never had a sibling. Just don't follow the organ music, alright? And And lastly, at number one, we have SCP-2480. The Sarkiks are one of the most prolific and dangerous groups of interest in the SCP universe, and this town is no exception. Right now, it's presumed neutralized, which is a freaky little classification. It went from safe to Keter to we really don't know where this is. Oh geez. 2480 is a dimensional anomaly in Massachusetts centered around a manor owned by someone in the cult known as Additum's Wake. Additum is a city ruled over by the Grand Karsist Ion. It seems that the Wake is trying to kill Ion, potentially to take control of some of these Sarkic sects. Whatever ritual that was performed here went terribly wrong though, leading to some deaths in the family. Self-inflicted gunshot wounds, implosion, fatal physical reconfiguration, you know, all the normal stuff. Researchers had noticed all sorts of weirdness in the town, like way too many children in each house and suspicious deaths, but didn't know the truth of it until they started taking exploratory DMT. This drug allowed people to see beyond the veneer into the strange, warped reality. The town was full of invisible, hooded figures with buildings made of flesh. The messages, "He is dreaming war and Additum will rise," are found, which seems to me like a doomsday waiting to happen. And of course, what is a creepy Lovecraftian town without some monsters? 2480 is home to massive humanoids, 4 meters tall, covered in pale, flabby flesh, walking around with their massive, toothy mouths and 3-fingered hands covered in viscera. Do not approach them, okay? It's been discovered that the flesh around town is mostly human, and that this reality is actually bleeding into ours. The Foundation and the Global Occult Coalition have teamed up to manage this anomaly, which is a sure sign of something crazy going on, because there's no explanation for these two organizations working together. None. So buckle up and maybe leave New England to the New Englanders. We're not really sure what's gonna happen. Presumed neutralized. Yeah, right. So there you have it, 5 sparkling, blood-soaked new additions to our SCP series. What did you think? Which one would you least like to run into? Are there any that you think are survivable? Make sure you let me know down in the comments. Speaking of comments, let's take a look at some of your more corny ones from the top 5 scary SCP secret societies. It's a lot of S's. The Crossroad Gathering says the Serpent's Hand is pretty cool. The Serpent's Hand is pretty cool. Just a bunch of anomalous folks trying not to be killed or imprisoned. They just wanna live, dammit. RJ Ellert says, "I like the Amnestic Hipster Cooperative, but you probably haven't heard of them." Well, actually, I liked them before they were cool, but these days I can't seem to remember why. Iron Ox says, "Well, I was going to throw away my rusty fork, but since you asked, thank goodness. Get to disemboweling straight away." Corseted Angel says, "My fictional dream job is being in product development for MC&D. I too have dreamt of having unlimited resources at my job for the mega rich." And Nazto89 says, "Not the most dangerous? SCP-5000 disagrees." Fair point, but for the sake of lists and considering that the Foundation is kind of like our protagonist in most cases, we'll ignore the alternate universe for now. And that's all the time we have for today. Before I work on my volcanic tightrope walking, make sure to give this video a big thumbs up and subscribe for more excellent entities. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time. Who's excited? No, that's not what I meant to say. And lastly, ooh.